So good evening guys, and today we will continue from where we left in last lecture. So we were discussing in last lecture for structural module about stress part. Now here in today's lecture we will move to next part, which is strain. So, guys, what do you mean by strain? Or any doubt from last class? What do you guys mean by stress? So, usually we know what is stress. Stress is like internal resistance provided by the structures against applied loading. But what is strain? Usually we define strain as what? Change in length to original length, right? Am I correct? You guys reply, guys, because without response for
Sir,
me.
so the
Am I
strain is
audible?
a
Yes, sir.
deformation due to applied load, sir.
Yes, that is what strain. Now strain is also a tensorial quantity. Okay, like stress, strain is also a tensorial quantity. Now there are two kind of strain: normal strain and shear strain. These are corresponding to what? Normal stress and shear stress. Now most of you are well aware about one fact, right? What you can write strain as, you can write strain as what? Delta L by L, right? But if I want to write my strain in terms of what? Displacement field, how we can write, anyone? In terms of displacement field, anyone? How we can write in terms of the displacement field? So you know, to write my strain in terms of displacement field, what we consider? We consider a line element A O B. Okay, this is a line element. Now if it is loaded, you will see this is the deformed shape. This is what the new is, a deformed shape. So in this deformed shape, if you want to write your strain in x direction, it will be given by epsilon x equal to dou u by dou x. What is the u here, guys? Anyone? What is the u, guys,
Velocity.
here? Is it velocity? Who said velocity? Anil? In
Displacement.
structure. In
Displacement.
structure. Then
In the
how you can?
extension.
It's a displacement in x direction. Okay. Because that deformation has to be represented by a displacement field. So this is u is what? My displacement field in x direction. Same way, my epsilon y, which is what? My strain in y direction is represented by what? Dou v by dou y. Clear? Now, my strain in z direction. Suppose if I have three-dimensional loading and three-dimensional structure, my strain in z direction is what? Epsilon z, and that is dou w by dou z. So these are.
Sir, not audible.
Hello guys, is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because some network issue was there. Okay, so just give me one moment. I'll resolve that issue. Okay, give me one moment. My this Wi-Fi router is getting switch off again and again. Okay. Now, guys, we know we have shear stresses also, right? So, what is my shear stresses, guys? We know tau xy, tau yz, and tau zx. So, there will be corresponding what? Shear strain. So, it is gamma zx. Sorry, corresponding to tau xy, it is gamma xy, corresponding to tau yz, gamma yz, and corresponding to tau zx, gamma zx. So these are what in terms of displacement field. So it is zx, so you can see the x component will be differentiated with respect to z, and w, which is third component, z component is differentiated with respect to x. So is it clear? Shear strain part. Now you guys will ask me how I have got this. So you guys can see this stress element. Is it visible, guys? Now here you can see when this line element got loaded, there is change in dimension along x and y direction for this line element. Also, there is change in angle between these two straight line. The initially angle is 90 degree. Now the angle became 90 minus gamma xy. So gamma xy is what here, guys? Anyone, what is gamma xy?
Yes,
Exactly, the shear strain in xy plane. Now, what is the gamma xy? Anyone can tell here from figure? Gamma xy will be theta 1 plus theta 2. Now, what is the theta 1 here? You guys can see my theta 1 is what? It is dou v by dou x.
Hello, sir. Unable to hear. Sir, your connection got cut, I think. Internet.
So I was discussing about this shear strain part. Okay. Now, as I told from this figure, what is theta 1? Anyone can tell me? Is it clear? It is dou v by dou x into delta x by delta x. Right. So delta x will be cancelled. Now, what is theta 2? Theta 2 will be dou u by dou y into delta y divided by delta y. So delta y get cancelled. So if you write here further, it is dou u by dou y into delta y by delta y. So finally, what we get from here, we'll get dou v by dou x plus dou u by dou y. Clear? So this is clear how we get shear strength part. Now further, these, you can see this, these all from Taylor series expansion. Okay, you guys try to understand. If not, then in next class I will tell you how these you know, displacement fields are written. Is it clear? Now
yes,
here
sir.
one thing has to be understand, when theta 1 will be positive and when theta 2 will be positive. So my theta 1 will be positive if it rotates in anti-clockwise direction, and when my theta 2 will be positive if it rotate in clockwise direction. That means you can see here this element is moving means inward. Okay, then your shear strain is positive. When theta 1 and theta 2 both are positive, then it is a new algebraic summation. So you can see when theta 1 is positive here, you know, Pawan, this was your doubt. So your doubt, now it is clear. Theta 1 is positive if this line element moves in this clockwise direction, and theta 2 is positive if my line element move in, see here in anti-clockwise and here it is in clockwise. Pawan, is it clear? Are you there?
I'm there. So what will happen if both the thetas move in?
Can you be a bit louder? I can't hear you. No, I can't hear you.
Hello.
Yeah, Pawan, you had doubt, right? No, your voice is not clear, Pawan. Is it clear? Sec. Strain is used in structural mechanics, in static, okay? And in fluid mechanics, we use rate of strain because fluid flows. Okay, so this part is clear. Let's move next. So these are my three shear strain. So you guys remember, most of you will be aware of what only, what is my strain. Most of you will say this is just delta L by L, but in your exam or in your interview, they may ask to write strain in terms of displacement fields. So clear, we can write normal strains also, and we can write our shear strains also. Okay, so let's move to next part. In last class we discussed about stress transformation. So same way we can have strain transformation also. Okay, but the only difference between stress and strain transformation is what? Pawan, if both angle are anti-clockwise, then there will be one will be of opposite sign. Okay, theta 1 will be positive but theta 2 will be negative. Is it clear, Pawan?
Yes,
Now, okay. Now, in strain transformation, what is the difference? Your shear stresses and shear stresses in that transformation matrix will be replaced by shear strain by 2. You can see here the tau st was replaced by gamma st by 2. Same way, gamma xy is replaced by gamma xy by 2. Remaining all terms are parallel. Is it clear? Because we know earlier what was our transformation matrix, sigma x, sigma y, and tau xy. Okay, or it is in the other, this is multiplied here, and here it was what? It was sigma s, sigma t, and tau st. Is it clear? This is c square, s square, 2cs, s square, c square, minus 2cs, minus cs, cs, c square, minus s square. What is here c? It's a cos theta. What is s? It is sine theta. Okay? Now here, once you know this transform, yeah, what Nityasri, if both angles are in same direction, no, it's not necessary. It's it means rigid body motion. You mean both angle are in same direction, okay? But it depends on the magnitude of angle. Nitya, if the magnitude of angle is same, then it's a rigid body motion. Clear? Okay. So once you know that this stress strain transformation, and here again it is depend on which matrix to be used, what is given. If your given is in x and y direction, then first matrix, if your the given values are in s and t direction, then second transformation matrix you should use. Now what is principal strains? So we know principal stresses, so same way we can find principal strain. Only the difference comes here. Here my tau xy is replaced by gamma xy by 2. Now what is my principal plane? It is 1 by 2 tan inverse gamma xy by epsilon xx minus epsilon yy, and we know theta 2 will be theta 1 plus 90 degree. Same way, what is maximum shear strain? It is again in that tau max formula, replace tau max by gamma max by 2 and tau xy as gamma xy by 2. Same way we can find plane of max here. So this is about your principal strain and max shear strain. Now we will take up problem. Guys, can you see the problem? Read the problem and solve.
1 second, principal strain formula.
Yeah, you want me to go back?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Any doubt here, Jaros?
Just noting down the formula, sir. Sure, remember.
Yeah. Okay, no problem. So clear?
Yes, sir. Next page.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Can I move?
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. So let's do this problem, guys. What is given here? For a loaded body member, body representing a two-dimensional plane problem, the displacement components along x and y at a point are u equal to x square plus y square and v equal to 2y. They are asking principal strain at a point 3 comma 1. Principal strain at a point 3 comma 1. So to find principal strain, first what we have to find, guys, anyone? We have to find epsilon x, we have to find epsilon y, and we have to find gamma xy. Am I correct? How we can
sir.
find epsilon x, epsilon y and gamma xy? Anyone? Yeah, anyone asking something?
Sir, continue.
Yeah, so can anyone tell how can I find epsilon x? Can I find
differentiating u with x?
Exactly, but earlier what you guys was knowing, just what is my strength, just delta L by L. Can we do that just knowing that much this problem? I don't think, right? So we already know what is epsilon x. It is dou u by dou x. Now what is u? They have given x square plus y square. So what is epsilon x coming, guys? 2x. Now what will be epsilon y? It will come as 2. What is the gamma xy will come? It is
2y.
Dou v by dou x plus dou u by dou y.
2y.
So 0 plus 2y. Am I correct? So you have everything, epsilon x, epsilon y and gamma xy. So substitute at 3 comma 1. 3 comma 1 substitute. So at 3 comma 1. Yeah, Sairam, you want to say something? Option B is correct. Yeah, I think option B is the correct answer. Others, everyone, quickly. So gamma xy substitute. So you'll get 6. Epsilon x will be 6. Epsilon y is 2. And gamma xy is how much? 2. Now you know everything. You know the formula. Can you find principal strain? Anyone? What is my principal strain formula? Epsilon 1 comma epsilon 2. Right? Is what? Epsilon x plus epsilon y by 2 plus minus. It is what? Epsilon x minus epsilon y by 2 whole square plus gamma xy by 2 square. Is it clear? Yeah, so everyone, what is the answer? B is the answer, right? B is the answer. So Priya, have you read these concepts earlier?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So everyone, B is the answer, right? So have this problem taken much time? We can solve this problem without Kelsey, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Even in your HL exam, problem may not be this tougher, okay? Even problem will be easier than this. So let's move to next problem. This kind of problem they may ask. It's a very simple problem, but you need to have a proper concept. So read this problem. What it says? In a material under a state of plane strain, a 10 by 10 mm square centered at a point gets deformed as shown in the figure. Okay. Now what we see, when we read the formula, this side should go inside, this side should also go inside. But here what we see, both are going in opposite direction. Am I correct? Yes or no, guys? Right. And we know the change in angle is what? It is pi by 2 minus gamma xy. Now here this pi by 2 minus gamma xy is what? It is equal to this value. So this is what? Pi by 2 plus 0.0005. So from here, how much is gamma xy, guys? It is -0.0005, right? But what is gamma xy given? It is already given as, how much it is given, guys? It is 0.001 k, right? So what is the k value, guys? What is k value? Exactly. D is the answer, right?
Yes.
Minus, from here we can find k will be equal to -0.5. Clear? So this kind of questions can be asked, okay? May not be this way, but some other way. So clear? This concept is clear about the strength part. Anyone has any concern?
Sir, why pi by 2 minus gamma xy?
Because you have seen in the concepts, when we derived, you can see the change in two perpendicular side. When gamma xy is positive, if both most close to each other, okay?
Okay,
so
sir.
Here this gamma xy is positive. So to have this positive, theta 1 should be anticlockwise, theta should be clockwise. Now for this, sign convention is given in Gehre book. Okay, I'll share the screenshot about SAM. The sign convention of shear strength corresponding to shear stress. Okay, clear? This question is also clear, guys. So what kind of, see, in exam they may simply ask what is the shear strain formula. Okay, four options they can give: shear strain in xy plane. What it is? It is very simple, right? It is gamma xy is equal to dou u by dou y plus dou v by dou x. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. So let's move to next concept, which is what? Very important. Stress strain relationship or constitutive relationship. So what is the stress strain relation, guys? You guys know very well, right? Anyone can tell. Hooke's law. So what is the Hooke's law? For mainly, I am talking here about metals, isotropic metal. What is the Hooke's law, guys? Anyone? Your stress is proportional to strain. So what is the stress? Sigma will be capital E times epsilon. Now what is capital E here, guys? Modulus of elasticity. Clear? Is it clear to everyone? Now guys, this is applicable only for uniaxial loading. Now suppose I have a plate and it is subjected to sigma x, sigma y. Tell me, guys, what is my strain? Anyone can tell what is my epsilon x and what is my epsilon y? Can anyone tell?
It depends on both the sigma x and sigma y, sir, with the Poisson's ratio.
Exactly. Right. So when you have multidimensional loading, you cannot use Hooke's law. Okay. There is something called Poisson effect will come in picture. So my strain in x direction will have combined effect of loading in x as well as in y direction. So my epsilon x will be what? It will be sigma x by E minus nu times sigma y by E. Clear? Is this clear? Now you guys will say why minus sign is coming. You can think physically when I'll try to explain physically this. See, it is very simple, guys. You take this plate. When you have only uniaxial loading, what will happen? It will try to shrink, right? But if you have biaxial loading, then what will happen? This shrinking will be less, right? Is it clear? Because this will not allow no EG to shrink, right? So what will happen? In your X direction, your strain will be lesser. Clear? Because that is your sigma y will shorten your strain in X direction. Okay, so this is physically also very clear. Now that measurement or that calculation is done using Poisson ratio. Okay, now what is the Poisson's ratio, guys? Anyone? What is the Poisson ratio for uniaxial loading? Anyone, guys? Poisson's ratio for uniaxial loading?
Ratio of the lateral and the longitudinal.
Exactly. Now, why I am telling uniaxial loading? Because this formula, what we say now, the ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain is only applicable for uniaxial loading. Okay. So the Poisson ratio is defined as the ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain, but with minus sign. Why minus sign is why? Why minus sign? You guys know when you apply sigma x, what is your strain in y direction? Anyone? Anyone? What is the your strain in y direction for sigma x alone? It will be minus nu times sigma x by e. So you know this minus sign will come. So to compensate here, always minus sign is there, because for metal, Poisson's ratio is always positive. Okay, for isotropic material, your Poisson's ratio are positive, or for metals, always Poisson's ratio is positive. So it is clear. Now, is it clear or not? What is the Poisson's ratio and why this negative sign is there? Now, once you know this, then if you have three-dimensional loading, means you have all three normal stresses, sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, then what will be your epsilon x? It will be sigma x by e minus nu sigma y by e minus nu sigma z by e. So you can see, if you write your epsilon x, it has three components, sigma x by e, then due to Poisson effect you have another two component. Is it clear? Same way, if you write epsilon y, it is what? Sigma y by e minus nu sigma x by e minus nu sigma z by e. Is it clear? Same way you can write epsilon z also. What is epsilon z here? Sigma z by e minus nu sigma x by e minus nu sigma y by e. Everyone is clear about this relation between normal strain to normal stresses? Okay, I can write this in matrix form. Okay, I can write this in matrix form. Okay, so in matrix form, what we can do, we can take 1 by e as a factor, then it is written as 1 minus nu minus nu minus nu 1 minus nu minus nu minus nu 1, and it is multiplied by sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. So try to remember things in matrix form. Okay, so you will do less mistakes. So it's good to, you know, remember in matrix form. Now, here what I have written, I have written my strain in terms of stresses. I can write my stresses in terms of strain by taking inverse of this matrix. So you guys can see in the next slide, my sigma x, sigma y and sigma z are my normal stresses and in terms of normal strain. So it is E upon 1 plus nu into 1 minus 2 nu, 1 minus nu, 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 then nu 1 minus nu, 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 1 minus nu, and it is multiplied by strain. Is it clear? Because if instead of stresses they have given strain value, how you can find stress by using this matrix? Okay, I am giving you guys more than what is required in your HL exam up to level of gate. You guys agree? They may not ask this much, but if you have better clarity than gate, it is all better clarity than what is required in exam, it is always helpful. I'll give the example of GATE 2021. Jaros, you agree, right? Or Ayushi? Our exams used to be tougher than if you compare with 2020 GATE or 2019 GATE. But what happened in finally? 2021 GATE was quite tougher. You guys all agree, right?
Yes, sir.
So those who are getting, you know, top 100 rank in IGC exam or top 50 rank in IGC exam, okay, all of them got rank under 100. So there are 35 students who got under 100 rank from IGC, okay, and all of them were getting under 50 rank in IGC exam. Those who are getting top 10 rank in IGC exam, out of that, I think 5 or 6 guys got again top 10 rank in GATE exam. So you understand the quality. If you have the quality work, one day it will be very useful. Okay, I'm giving this just for you guys understanding. Try to read as much as, though it is HL exam, it may not be in very tough, but time will be less. Okay, so you need to remember more. So it's clear up to this? Is clear? I will share the few more my experiences further, having good knowledge how it is useful. So clear?
Sir, is there a trick to remember all those?
So it is very trick, a simple trick, na Jaros. You remember in matrix form, this is a symmetric matrix, right?
Yes, sir.
So that way you can write. If you remember first row, all the rows you can write. See, you can see here one minus nu is corresponding to these. If it is a second row, then in second, right? Okay. Third row means at the last column. Only you have to remember what? This factor. So like that is why I have written transformation matrix also here, you guys can see in matrix form, right? So we can remember always, right? C square, S square, then minus 2 CS, S square, C square. So this is bit practice. If you do, you will remember forever. Now, once you know the relation between normal stress and normal strain, next is what? The relation between shear stress and shear strain. So the relation between shear stress and shear strain is given by this. Your gamma is always 2 into 1 plus nu by E into tau. Or your tau is what? Your tau is E upon 2 into 1 plus nu into gamma. Now tell me guys, what is this E upon 2 into 1 plus nu? Anyone? Surely they will ask one question from here. Yeah, anyone telling something?
Shear modulus.
Exactly, shear modulus. Modulus of rigidity or shear modulus. So my G is what? E upon 2 into 1 plus nu. What question they may ask? They may ask direct, what is the formula, correct formula? What is the modulus of rigidity? Or what is your modulus of elasticity? Okay. Or what they can do? They can give some value of E and nu. They may ask G. Or they may give the value of G and nu. They may ask E. Or they may give the value of G and E. They may ask nu. So some calculation also they may ask you, or they may ask you direct formula. Clear? This is very important formula. Even in GATE exam, there are questions from these formulas. Now, since this factor is G, so what is your tau? Tau is G into gamma. Or what is your gamma? It is tau by G. So you can see gamma xy is what? Tau xy by G. Gamma yz is tau yz by G. Gamma zx is what? Tau zx by G. Is it clear to everyone? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's move to next part. These are again very important concept. Plane stress problem and plane strain problem. So what is the plane stress problem, guys? Anyone?
Zero strain. We have zero shear strain.
No. Plane stress problem is a plane. Yes, zero.
In that plane, only stress will be there.
Yes. So it is like this. For a plane stress problem, suppose this is my plane of plane stress problem, x and y. Then there won't be any stress in z direction, like sigma z, tau xz, tau yz, all will be zero. Okay, if you say my xy plane is plane of plane stress problem. But what you will see, your gamma, your epsilon z may not be zero in this case. Why? Why epsilon z is not zero?
Because it has sigma x and sigma y terms.
Again, from constitutive relation or your stress strain relation, due to Poisson effect, your epsilon z is what? Minus nu times sigma x plus sigma y by E. So what we see, there is strain in out of plane direction for a plane stress problem. Clear? Though your sigma z, tau yz and tau xz are zero. So if you see, your non-zero stresses are what? Three stresses, which is what? Sigma x, sigma y and tau xy. But you have four non-zero strain, which is what? Epsilon x, epsilon y, epsilon z and gamma xy. Clear? Is this clear? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So you can see here, constitutive relation I have written. Okay, epsilon x is what? Sigma x by E minus nu sigma y by E. This is epsilon y, and this is what? Epsilon z, which is non-zero for a plane stress problem in xy plane. What is your gamma xy? It will be same tau xy by g. So is it clear? What is the plane stress problem? Now, same way, you can say, suppose my plane of plane stress problem is yz. Clear? So in this case, guys, what will be epsilon x, zero or non-zero?
Non-zero.
Exactly. And what will be the value? It will be nu times nu by e sigma y plus sigma z. Clear? So is this clear? This is what plane stress problem in yz plane. So in your exam, they may change your plane. Okay, they may change your plane. Instead of xy, they can ask yz or they can ask zx also. In usually in gate, they play all these tricks. Okay, but in your HL exam, they may not. Clear? This concept's clear? So once you know plane stress problem, next is what? Plane strain problem. So guys, what is plane strain problem? Anyone?
But the strains are only in two dimensions.
Yes, it is opposite to stress. So in this case, suppose if you take a problem and this is my XY plane. So what is the condition for plane strain problem? Your epsilon z will be zero, your gamma xz will be zero, and your gamma xz is zero, gamma yz is zero. Clear? So if your epsilon z is zero, then tell me what will be sigma z? Anyone? Zero or non-zero? Non-zero, right? Why non-zero? Because you know this third term, it is what, epsilon y, then epsilon z, it is zero. But this right hand side is not zero, right? So from here, what we find, your sigma z for plane strain problem is what? Nu times sigma x plus sigma y. Is it clear? And three times in gate, there is a question from plane strain problem. Okay, is it clear? So for plane strain problem, non-zero stresses are what? Sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, and tau xy. So there are four non-zero stresses, but non-zero strains are three. Is it clear, Funda? What is plane stress problem and what is your plane strain problem? Tell guys quickly.
Sir, me.
Clear. Okay. Now I am asking one question. Can you guys tell anyone a case when a problem, given problem is both, it's a plane stress problem and it is also plane strain problem? Anyone can tell any case, one case where a given problem is both plane strain as well as plane stress problem? You guys know biaxial stress system we discussed. In that biaxial,
sigma x and sigma y are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction.
Exactly, very good. So in that case, what will happen? This sigma z will be also zero and epsilon z will be also zero. Clear? Because your sigma x is equal to minus of sigma y. Clear? So this particular problem is of both plane stress as well as plane strain problem. Same case, pure shear also will be having both plane stress and plane strain problem. Because in that case, sigma x and sigma y are already zero. Is it clear? Is this clear to everyone or no? Yes or no? Anyone has any doubt till now? Yeah, there are questions. What is Sairam? Can we say in other word, what is? Can you say other word, the plane stress in negligible stresses in thickness direction? See, usually our thin walled structure are undergo plane stress problem because we in thickness direction stresses will be negligible. But the example of plane strain problem, you know, dam structure is a example of plane strain problem. Okay, a long structure under subjected to pressure loading. Clear this? Okay, so let's move to problems. I think now, yeah, so there they can ask simple question. The first question is what? The number of independent elastic constant required to define stress-strain relationship for an isotropic elastic solid. Guys, how many independent elastic constant? Anyone? Priya, 5. These are constant, not stresses. Priya, you have written GATE multiple times. It's a twice they asked this question in GATE. They are not talking about stresses. They are talking about material constant. So there are two only material constant required. Why? Because E, nu and G can be written in each other term. Okay, either E and nu or nu and G or E and G. Clear? So if two are given, third we can find. Because we already know what is G. G is E upon 2 into 1 plus nu. Right? Okay, so can we move to next question? What is the next question here? Read the next question, guys. For an elastic anisotropic solid, the number of independent elastic constant in its constitutive relation is, this can be asked in your HL exam. How many? Anyone remember? I have not discussed this. If you guys remember, tell me. Exactly 21. So for anisotropic material, the number of independent constant will be 21. The matrix will be 36
whether
by
it is
36.
Biaxial or triaxial stress?
No. It is biaxial or triaxial is elastic.
For biaxial it is 6, sir.
No. It's a triaxial, okay? It's a generalized.
Okay.
In generalized, anisotropic means what? First tell me what anisotropy. In all the three direction, your material properties are different, okay? So that is what? Anisotropic material. So there will be 36 constant. Out of 36, it's a symmetric matrix. So 21 will be independent. Okay. So how many material constant? For orthotropic, it is 9. For monoclinic, it is 13. Okay. So for orthotropic material, what is the orthotropic material, guys? Anyone? What is the orthotropic material? In three
material properties are different in mutually perpendicular direction.
Yes, in mutually perpendicular direction, properties are different, and the independent material constant for orthotropic material, for orthotropic materials are 9. Okay, 9. So what is those 9? 3 mu, 3 nu, 3 e, and 3 जी क्लियर. फॉर ऑर्थोट्रॉपिक देर आर टोटल 9, सो 3 न्यू वैल्यू, 3 ई वैल्यू एंड 3 जी वैल्यू. क्लियर इज दिस? सो लेट्स सी दीज टू क्वेश्चन. टेल मी द आंसर गाइस. आई हैव डिस्कस्ड द कॉन्सेप्ट्स. Tell me the answer, guys. So first question is what? For a plane strain problem in XY plane, in general, the non-zero stresses. So how many non-zero stresses for plane strain problem? There will be 4. So which all 4? We know sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz, and sigma xy. So which is the correct answer? Which is the correct answer, guys? Yes, D is the correct answer. D is the correct answer. Clear to everyone? D is the correct answer. We can see sigma xx.
D, there is a y, sigma yz term.
Where is yz term? Not sigma zz.
Okay.
Okay, here it is bit not visible.
Yes, sir.
But it is sigma zz. Okay. Okay. Everyone, is it clear? Okay, so is it clear to everyone? Anyone has any doubt in this? So D is clear. Jaros, D is the clear?
Yes, sir.
Anush, yeah. Okay, so fine. Let's see the next question. For a plane strain problem, the stresses satisfies the condition. So tell me guys, which condition satisfy? Tau xz equal to tau yz equal to sigma z equal to 0, no. Tau xz equal to tau yz is 0, yes. And sigma z nu times sigma x plus sigma y. Correct? This. Third is also wrong, fourth is also wrong. So what is the correct answer? B is the correct answer. So is okay. Now, so in a three-dimensional linear elastic solid, the number of non-trivial stress-strain relation, how many stress strain relation we have seen? 6, right?
6.
Three between normal stress and normal strain, and 3 between shear stress and shear strain. Then strain displacement equations, how many? 6. How many equilibrium equation? 3. So what is the answer? C is the answer. Now, what is the Poisson's ratio for aircraft gate metallic alloy? So usually for aluminium alloy, my Poisson ratio is around 0.3. Okay, so what is the answer?
C
is the answer. Anyone was asking something? Someone was asking something.
Nothing.
No, sir. I was just telling the answer.
Yeah. Thank you. No issue. All right. Yeah. Let's move to next question. Next concept. Yeah, volumetric strain or dilatations. So what is the volumetric strain, guys? Anyone? Anyone tell me, is volumetric strain, what is volumetric strain? One thing tell me, guys, is
change
there
in
any
volume by original value.
Yeah, that is one. Is there any contribution in volume change due to shear stress? Anyone? That can be an interview question. Suppose your body is subjected to shear stress a lot. Will there be any change in volume?
No.
Shear stress only distort your
acting
structure.
Surface area only. It is acting on only area.
Yeah, it will not change your volume, but only it will distort your structure. But the volume change is done by only normal stress. So you have three normal stresses for a three-dimensional body. So that will change your volume. Either it can increase your volume or it can decrease your volume based on the sign of your normal stress. So the change in volume to original volume is known as volumetric strain. For a three-dimensional body, if you go in derivation part, you'll find your volumetric strain is summation of your normal strain in x direction plus normal strain in y direction plus normal strain in z direction. Is it clear? Is this clear? Yeah. Now I can write this epsilon x, epsilon y, epsilon z in terms of normal stresses. And if I write in terms of normal stresses, then your formula of volumetric strain will be this 1 minus 2 nu upon E into sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z. Now, guys, tell me, what is the hydrostatic loading? Anyone can tell what is the hydrostatic loading? What is the hydrostatic loading? A loading, pressure loading, right? So in case of pressure, what you see, what it will be, sigma x is equal to sigma y is equal to sigma z. If we have a pressure loading, it will be equal to pressure. You all agree? So the pressure loading is what your hydrostatic loading. Now you can
compressive
have
stresses, right, sir?
No, it depends. You can see the your gas cylinder. Your pressure is outward, right? So you will not have compressive, it will have tensile. But you can have a body immersed in water, right? So that body may feel compressive stresses because you in surrounding everywhere you have a pressure, right? So if my hydrostatic loading in such a way, if your stresses are compressive, then it is minus P, then what will happen? If your stresses are compressing, your volume will shrink. If your stresses are tensile, your volume will increase. So that you can see, if sigma x equal to sigma y equal to sigma z equal to minus p, if you have inward pressure, then your volumetric strain will be negative. And it is given by what? Minus 3 into 1 minus 2 nu by E into p. Now, what is this, guys? Anyone? E upon 3 into 1 minus 2 nu. What is this?
Bulk
K.
modulus.
K is bulk. Known as bulk modulus. Now, if you do not want any change in volume, what you should have to do? What you have to do? If you do not want any change in volume, what you should do? I can write first, what is your E? Your E is minus P by K. Now, if you do not want any change in volume, what should be K? What should be the K value?
Infinite.
Exactly, infinite. So when K will be infinite, anyone can tell from this formula?
Mu equal to 0.5.
Exactly. This is a gate question in gate mechanical. For perfectly incompressible solid, what is the value of nu? Tell me.
0.5.
Exactly. So this is how the question can be arised. Okay. So first you should remember, this is very important formula. In HL exam, they may ask directly, what is the bulk modulus? So it is E upon 2 into 1 minus nu, or any numerical, they may give nu value or anything. Okay. Now, guys, further, there is one important thing. Can you guys tell me, can you have nu greater than 0.5 for any material? Can you have nu greater than 0.5? Yes or no? Tell me, guys, quickly. No. Why no? Because if nu is greater than 0.5, then K will become negative, which is not possible. Okay, your bulk modulus should be positive always. So that is why nu for any material, it can be maximum equal to 0.5 or less than 0.5. That is so. The upper limit of nu is restricted by what? Bulk modulus of elasticity. Now, you guys know what is the E? G. What is the G? It is E upon 2 into 1 plus nu. Now, tell me, guys, can nu is lesser than minus 1? Can you have nu lesser than minus 1? Yes or no?
G will become negative.
It cannot be lesser than minus 1. Any material, not just metal, nu cannot be lesser than minus 1. If it is lesser than minus 1, your G will be negative, which is not possible. Okay, which should not be the case. So you can see the value of nu always vary between minus 1 to 0.5 for every material. Clear? So nu should be greater than equal to minus 5, less than equal to, here it is written, I think, reverse. Here some typo. Okay? It should be less than equal to 0.5, greater than equal to minus 1. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Anyone has any doubt, concern? Okay. No? Yes or no? Am I going with right speed? If anyone not understanding, tell me. I'm not going in derivation part, but I'm trying to cover each concept. What I practice in gate classes. So you guys have seen how the IGC gate classes are different. I'm asking to those who are not from IGC team, from IGC family. Okay, all right. Let's move to questioner. So this is the first question. It is a very straightforward question. Guys, solve this. We already discussed the answer, right? What is the answer, guys?
B, sir.
Yeah, B is the answer. Already we have discussed. The Poisson's ratio The Poisson's ratio for perfectly incompressible linear elastic material is 0.5. How 0.5? Because we know what is your K. Your K is E upon 1 minus 2 nu. E upon 3 into 1 minus 2 nu, right? Now, K has to be infinity for perfectly incompressible elastic material. When K is infinity, if nu is 0.5, then your K will be infinity. Okay? So let's move to next question. Yeah, this is from Gate Aerospace 2020. It is again a simple question. You can see the value of Poisson's ratio at which shear modulus of an isotropic material is equal to bulk modulus, right? So what they said, your G is equal to K. What is your G, guys? Right, this is they told shear modulus is equal to bulk modulus. What is G? It is E upon 2 into 1 plus nu. What is your K? It is E upon 3 into 1 minus 2 nu. Can we find from here the nu value? Clear? So here you can see nu will get cancelled. So we'll get 2 plus 2 nu is equal to 3 minus 6 nu. So we'll get 8 nu equal to 1. So nu equal to 1 by 8. Is it tough question? No. So such question can be asked in your HL exam. If I am examiner, definitely I will ask such question. Okay. Not lengthy, but involving concepts. So guys, do this question. So based on given formula. So what is the question here? If the Poisson's ratio of an elastic material is 0.4, the ratio of modulus of rigidity to Young's modulus. So we know, guys, what is G? It is E upon 2 into 1 plus nu. So they ask the ratio of modulus of rigidity to Young's modulus, means G by E. So it is what? 1 upon 2 into 1 plus nu. They have given nu value as 0.4. Guys, can solve this question?
0.36.
How much it is coming, guys?
0.6.
Point?
36.
357.
357.
357, yeah. Clear?
Sir, in HAL exam, whether they allow calculator or not?
No calculator. You have to do all hand calculation quickly. That's why the tough questions we are not going to practice. It's all simple question. Only thing you need to remember all the concepts well. Okay, so that's why
this type of questions and options will be there, right, sir?
Yeah, option four. Every all the questions will have MCQ only, no NAT and all. Okay. Yeah. Let's discuss next concept. Any doubt till now, guys? Okay. Yeah, good to hear, no doubt. So the next is what is thermal stresses and strains. Now you guys know, when we have mechanical loading, we will have mechanical strain. But when we have thermal loading, mostly in practical cases, you'll have both loads, thermal loads and mechanical load. So when we have thermal load, we will have thermal stresses and thermal strain. But the behavior of thermal stresses and thermal strain is different. Now take, if you have a three-dimensional load structure, and it is subjected to some temperature delta T, okay, and it is free to move in all the direction. So in that case, if alpha is my coefficient of thermal expansion, so my strain in all the direction, it will be what? It will be alpha delta T. Now tell me, guys, what will be the corresponding stress if all the direction are free to expand? What is your stress?
E into alpha delta T.
Wrong. It will be zero if all the faces are, you know, free to move. Then there will no thermal stress. But you know, some people will say Hooke's law says stress is proportional to strain. No, that is only applicable in case of mechanical load. So in case of thermal load, though thermal strain is there, but thermal stress not need to be there. Now thermal stress will be there only due to mechanical constraint. What is the mechanical constraint, guys? If you restrain any side to expand, so in that case, what will happen? This strain will change and you may have a stress. Clear? Is this point clear? So in any practical structure or loading, your total strain will be what? Summation of thermal strain and mechanical strain. Now we guys know already, these are what our mechanical strain, and we know in the all the direction your thermal strains are same. So you can see, if you have both thermal loading and mechanical loading, also you have constraint in all the direction, these will be my total strain in x direction, y direction and z direction. So is this clear? Now when my student Mr. Ram Gopal Soni went for DRDO interview, the first question they asked, what is total strain? What was the first question? What do you mean by total strain? Okay, his interview was in 2020 around, and this same thing we taught him in 2017. He appeared in 2018 gate, and we discussed all these things in 2017. So is it clear? How, you know, if someone knows things in the better way, can be useful. Nobody said, right, to interview guys, he asked him question from this part, but they ask. So guys, this is how this learning will be helpful. Now we know my total strain is what? Mechanical strain plus thermal strain. But in your curriculum, what is the thermal strain you have studied? It is only for bar, right? Am I correct? Only for bar. For what you have studied? For bar loading, right? Only for bar. So in case of bar, you guys remember, right? What is bar? Anyone can tell what is the bar structure? Axially loaded structure, right? It's a bar structure. So you guys will be knowing only this case, ki I have a bar and it is fixed on both the side and it is subjected to some temperature delta T. So what is my thermal stress? E alpha delta T. Then tell me what is your strain? In x direction you will have zero strain, but you may have strain in y direction. Nobody discuss, no one discuss that part, okay? But let's see here how we discuss. So first case, when you have only thermal loading and there is no constraint, so that is what I told, your all the strain will be equal to alpha delta T, but your all the stresses will be zero. Then the case two, when you have only thermal loading but constraint in x direction, that is what the case of bar. So when you have only constraint in x direction, this epsilon x will be zero, okay? This epsilon x will be zero, but it is free to expand in y and z direction. So your sigma y will be zero, sigma z will be zero. Clear? So from here, guys, tell me what will be sigma x from this formula. For this case, what is it? Is constant in x direction, so this total is zero, and also it is free to expand in y and z direction. So sigma y is zero, sigma z is zero. So what will be sigma x? It will come as minus e alpha delta t. Clear, guys? So this e alpha delta t is not from Hooke's law, it is from this way. Is it clear? It is not like that. You have alpha delta T thermal strain, so your shear, your normal stress is what? E alpha delta T. No, it is not that way. Is this point clear? Not. Tell me, guys. Yes. No.
Can it be a plus sign, not a minus sign?
No, it is always minus sign. Thermal stress is always negative or compressive if your temperature is positive. It is always compressive nature. Yeah, in case one, thermal stresses are zero. So is it clear? That whatever the, you guys have learnt now, that bar alpha delta T and E alpha delta T, that is the wrong way of learning, okay, in case of thermal loading. So now it is clear how we got this minus E alpha delta T. This is the only right way. Now, guys, nobody bothered about total strain in Y and Z direction for a bar problem where both the ends are fixed and subjected to temperature delta T. Anyone can tell me what will be your epsilon y and what will be epsilon z? These are what my lateral strain for a bar problem. Anyone? We already know what is sigma x. We got minus alpha delta T into E. Can you guys substitute in these two equations? We know. So what you will get? You'll get these value as 1 plus nu into alpha delta T. Is it clear? It is. So your lateral strain will not be alpha delta T. Now it will be 1 plus nu times alpha delta T. Yeah, anyone is saying something? Anyone is saying something? So is it clear? Yes or no, guys? You guys
yes,
can
sir.
Take time. Take time, everyone. Please take time. Have a look in this slide. Solve it and tell me. So none of the I didn't see any writer discuss this lateral strain in case of thermal loading for a bar problem. Okay. Sek, have you come across this kind of stuff earlier?
Sir.
Okay, no problem. So this is very useful actually. Okay, in practical problems all these things will be there. Okay, in practical problems, okay, because always you will have lateral strain, but you know, in literature less people are discussing this part because it's a bit complicated to understand for many people. Okay, now we have discussed this, right? And we have already got this. Now case three. In case three, what I am constraining in x and y direction, two direction, not just one direction, two direction. Suppose you take a plate, okay, or a thick plate. And you have constraint in x and y direction. So what will happen? If you constraint in x and y direction, your sigma x and sigma y will be non-zero. But your capital X and capital epsilon x and capital epsilon y will be zero, right? Because you are constraining total strain in x and y direction. Now in this case, for simplification, we are assuming sigma x is equal to sigma y. Sigma x is equal to sigma y. Okay, then you can say substitute this all in that equation we have now, that before the equation first. This is zero, this is non-zero, this also non-zero, this is zero, but sigma x equal to sigma y. Then solve and find out sigma x. If you solve and find sigma x, you can see from this equation, you'll get sigma x is equal to sigma y is equal to minus e alpha delta t upon 1 minus e. Now you guys are all aware, what is your alpha, sigma? Everyone will say e alpha delta t, but you see here, it is not the case. Is it clear? Is this clear or not? This is the actual thermal stress when two sides are constrained. It is not E alpha delta T, it is minus E alpha delta T upon 1 minus nu. Now tell me guys, the previous value is more or this value will be more? Tell me guys, which is more value?
This one will be more.
Exactly, because two sides are constrained, so you'll have more thermal stresses. Now we can find now by substituting these two in your total strain, you can find your strain in z direction. So what will be strain in z direction? For when two sides are constrained, it is 1 plus nu upon 1 minus nu into alpha delta t. Now tell me, this is higher the or the previous lateral strains are higher? Which one is higher? The previously what we got, 1 plus nu into alpha delta t. Now in this case what we got, 1 plus nu upon 1 minus nu into alpha delta t. So which is greater? This is greater, right?
This case is greater.
Exactly. So this is with physics. When you are not allowing to expand in two direction, automatically third direction will expand more. Is it clear? Is this point clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So let's discuss last concepts. Last case four. And you know, from case four, there are a couple of questions has been asked in gate mechanical and gate XC. What is case four? All the three direction are constrained. X, Y and Z, all three. So that means what? your capital X zero, capital Y zero, and epsilon Z zero. But all three will be non-zero. Sigma X, sigma Y, and sigma Z are non-zero. So we are again saying, again, use that equation first. This equation, and this is zero, but this and this equal, and from there, if you solve, you will get this. The formula of thermal stress will be minus E alpha delta T upon 1 minus 2 nu. Now tell me, guys, which is greater? This is greater or this is greater?
Case 4.
Case 4 is greater because you are constraining in all three directions. And your total strength will be 0 in all three directions because all the sides are constraints. So is this clear? Is this concept is clear? Okay. Now additional concept, I have completed basic elasticity. The additional concept is what you can have strain energy density. Strain energy density. Anyone can tell what is the strain energy density? If you the plot a curve between sigma and epsilon, the area under this curve is what? Strain energy density. So what it is? It will be strain energy density. So it is denoted by, it is denoted by what? Sometimes they denote it by small v. So it is 1 by 2 sigma into E. Now, if we take three normal stresses, so it will be what? Summation. 1 by 2 sigma x epsilon x plus 1 by 2 sigma y epsilon y plus 1 by 2 sigma z into epsilon z. Clear? So this is what? Normal strain energy density. Same way, we can have shear strain energy density. So that will be what? 1 by 2 tau xy gamma xy plus 1 by 2 tau xz gamma xz plus 1 by 2 tau yz gamma yz. Clear? My total strain energy density will be what? Summation of this shear and this normal volumetric. Okay, so is this clear about strain energy density part? Anyway, there may not be any question from this part, but I am just discussing because we already know normal stresses and shear stresses, normal strain and shear strain. So we can find strain energy density. Now guys, what is the total strain energy? Anyone can tell what is the total strain energy? It is always strain energy density into volume is what your total strain energy. Okay. Is this point clear? Strain energy density into total volume is what? Total strain energy. So I think we have done. And thank you guys, and now if you guys have any question, be free to ask. So whatever I planned for today, I have completed. I am free to take up question or any doubt. Now Pawan, you had one doubt, so that question I can take up. It was bit complicated question, but I will explain that question. Anyone has any doubt? Anyone has any doubt? Okay. So Pawan, your question is like this. If I draw that question, initially it is a square. Okay, now what happened? when it is subjected to load, it becomes like this. If I remember, it becomes like this. Okay. Is it right? So there are quantity. How you can find epsilon x? You can find epsilon x like this change by total this change. How you can find epsilon y? See, you can see this is going up, but there is further this expansion also there. So you have to find this minus this by total. You can find epsilon y. But gamma x by v will be what? This will be positive, but this will be negative. This is positive, but this is negative. Clear? Pawan, is it clear? So gamma x y will be what? Theta 1, and it will be minus. Or you can say theta 1 plus theta 2, but it will be minus sign here. The difference between engineering strain and shear strain, yes. See what happened. Fourth, is it not fourth question? I think fourth question is from strain transformation, right? That is a bit lengthier question. Is that question where they told the change in length of diagonal, right? Is that question change in the length of the major diagonal? Is that question yes or no? Yeah, so that also I can tell you how to solve that question. Guys, look here. Suppose you have a plate and they gave coordinate. This is O, or this is P, Q, R, S. Now guys, look here. They told it is deforming. Okay. Like that, deforming. And they gave epsilon x, epsilon y, and epsilon gamma xy. Okay, they gave epsilon x, epsilon y, and gamma xy. Now guys, here you can find this angle. You can find this angle. Once you know this angle, you can find your strain along this angle, right? Epsilon theta, right? From transformation matrix. So what will be? It will be C square epsilon x plus S square epsilon y plus 2CS gamma xy. What is here C? C is cos theta and S is sine theta. Once you know this epsilon theta, what is your epsilon theta? It will be PR dash minus PR upon PR. What they asked? PR dash. So what will be your PR dash? My PR dash will be 1 plus epsilon theta into PR. Is it clear? This method is clear? Pawan, is it clear? But such questions cannot be asked in your HL exam. Is it clear now? Respond on this. Yes or no? Yeah, mic is not working is fine, but is it correct or not? You understood or not? What you have to do? First, you have to find the strain along this diagonal direction. that how you can finding this angle theta, because they have given these sides, coordinate of these sides. Once you know theta from transformation matrix, find epsilon theta. And we know from the definition of strain, the strain along theta direction is what? The final length minus initial length upon initial length. So clear? Is this clear? So that's all from my side. Anyone has any concern or any doubt?